Now, the last section that we are going to consider is the contradictions of Blackwell. It is generally said that the galaxy cannot survive without a supermassive black hole, because a classical model of universe says that it was the supermassive black hole which created the galaxy in the first place. So if you remove it, then the galaxy would disintegrate. To try and explain you a bit more Newtonianly, or with Einstein's formula, what you have is you have two basic masses, and the Newton says that there is an force of attraction which is known as gravity between the two masses, which is directly proportional to the two masses and inversely proportional to the square of the distance that separates it. So bigger the mass, the stronger the influence, and farther it is, lesser is the influence. The same thing is, the gravity is slightly differently formulated by Einstein, who says that every massive mass has the tendency to bend the shape of the space around it, and the space which is bent so, in turn, guides the smaller masses how to move around it. So what it is saying is that when you have a larger mass, it is bending the space, and the bent space is telling this particular mass how to move around it. In the sense, if this is a bigger mass, then this would be closer to it. If it is a smaller mass, it would move away from it. So this is what we say: larger the mass, steeper the gradient, stronger the influence. Alternately, smaller the mass, gentler the gradient, weaker is the influence. So it looks so commonsensical that if this is the mass which is holding this mass in position, you take this away, the supermassive black hole, from the center. This mass, there is no one to guide it, though there is no one to have a hold on it. It is free to move. And that is how it is said that when you have this galactic mass, all the stars going around the supermassive black hole, it is the supermassive black hole which is holding them in place. You take out this supermassive black hole, the stars would feel free to fly away in a direction which is tangential to wherever they are, and the whole galaxy would disintegrate. We will also remove the black hole, but we will not remove it right away. We will reduce the size of the supermassive black hole. We know that it weighs 4 million suns. Let us, as an experiment, just take one sun mass out of it. Now the supermassive black hole weighs as much as 3,999,000 suns. What happens to the galaxy? So we have made this supermassive black hole slightly lighter. The influence will be lesser. So the mass which was here would move out. This would, all the stars would move out slightly, maybe a millimeter, maybe less than that. But the stars are not flying away, the galaxy is not disintegrating. Let us go one step further. Now let us again remove 100 sun masses from the supermassive black hole. Now again, the influence decreases a bit, but the stars don't fly away, galaxy doesn't disintegrate, the galaxy size increases. The shape is the same, but the size increases. Let us now cut it into half, 2 million sun masses, the supermassive black hole. Again, the stars are not flying away, the galaxy is not disintegrated, but now the size of the galaxy is supersized because the influence is less, but the galaxy has not disintegrated. You can keep doing this till you come to a situation where the black hole at the center is just one sun mass. Even then, the stars would be going around. They would not be flying away. The galaxy is not getting disintegrated. So even when you remove that one last sun mass weight, even then the galaxy would keep on following the orbit that it was. It is just that it is bigger in size. And this is the contradiction that we talk about. And how does spacity take care of this? Spacity, fortunately, has got S3. And as you can see, S3 does not need a mass at the center, whether it is supermassive or any mass. If it is there, it is good. If it is a supermassive mass, then the orbit reduces. But it does not depend on a central mass at all. If you remove this central mass, the S3 would keep these masses in orbit. Now, one may say, if at all you the galaxy can survive the supermassive black hole, how did the galaxy form in the first place? You could visit my previous videos related to early universe, how the galaxies were formed. We explained how galaxies can form without the use of gravity, without the use of a supermassive black hole at the center, without the use of dark matter. We just used the highly ionized charged particles that the gas would be to begin with in early universe. You can visit that video and it explains all these situations. And the next contradiction that I want you to talk to you about are theoretical in nature. But you know, whenever we propose a theory, theorem, it should be applicable both in theory as well as in practice. The assumptions that we are making here is, you see all the constituents of this mass, of this galaxy, which is basically the stars in the inner ring, stars in the spiral arm, and the supermassive black hole at the center. Now, what happens? Does the classical model of universe, which is based on Einstein's general theory of relativity, of the massive mass bending the space and the space guiding the smaller masses how to move around, does it allow for a model which has the black hole as one sun mass and each star that you see as equivalent to one sun mass? In the sense, any mass that is there is the same everywhere. What would happen in a classical model of universe? You have the supermassive black hole at the center, you have these stars, the space that this star, the sun which is bending, would have no effect on these stars at all, which would as good as to say that these masses would be free to move and this whole galaxy of this model would disintegrate. Such a model is not possible at all. Such should not be the case. Theorem should take care of whether the supermassive black hole, small, big, small, all possible cases should be applicable. This is what happens in spacity. The Manthan model, which depends on spacity, has got S1, S2, S3. S3 takes care of these, keeping these masses in orbit. You can visit the previous videos of why spacity. It tells you the mandate of spacity is to act on the mass for every form of energy. Mass being another form of energy, it is acted upon. If it is, and how it acts, it depends on the state of the mass that is in. If it is one, then it is a compressive force. If it is two, it is trying to bring them together to make it one and then act on it. If there is a system of mass already acting on it, then it is acting in the general direction, because the mandate of spacity is to keep the masses in the huddle, because if it is acting in any which way, the masses would fly away. So in this case, S3 would still act on these and make this galaxy work. So that is why we say that the classical model of universe has got a contradiction, which Manthan model clearly explains. The third case, or the contradiction, is merging of twin black holes. We all know merging of black holes. So you have two black holes, they just come and merge. But this again is theory. This never happens in reality. Let us assume you have a black hole. I, through magic, may create another black hole, which is exactly a replica of the first black hole. Don't ask me how, it's magic. I have two black holes which are exactly similar in every size, shape, matter, density, intensity, whichever way you compare them, they are twin in nature. It's as though, you know, control C, control V. You take one black hole, copy paste it and make another black hole. Why do I say twin black hole? What happens? How do they bend the space? Each would bend the space exactly in the same way as the other one does. If the gradient of this is x, the gradient of the other one is also x. And we are assuming that this universe, in this theoretical universe, there is only these two twin black holes, nothing else to bother them. So the gradient would be similar. Now see what happens when these two masses are coming together. They are not coming head on, because if they are coming head on, they will crash. Let us assume that they are going their way off. Generally, what we have seen is these two masses, when they come, they should come here and then merge. But in this case, when the gradient is the same, this black hole will not be able to guide the other black hole as to how to move around it. If this was slightly lesser than that, this would tell it how to move around it. Now that both are same, both will not be able to have influence over the other. It is as though when these two masses are coming, they are blind to each other. They cannot influence each other. They just walk away. And we see that it doesn't happen so. This takes care of in Manthan model. How does that do? Manthan model, you can see S2. It does not make a difference whether it is equal masses or unequal masses. It just brings them together, because it is operating from outside. So this is what I wanted to talk to you about black hole, the various aspects of it. Hope it was interesting. Thanks for watching.